One of the most crucial scientific breakthroughs over the next decade is most certainly going to relate to energy storage. With aging infrastructure, increased weather severity, increased penetration of renewables, and the ever-growing energy demand, the world's problem solvers will need to completely reimagine the grid. We have covered so many different types of energy storage, from air and liquid metal batteries to mechanical energy storage. Today, we're going to look at one of the most promising grid storage solutions that I've come across, the flow battery, and one company in particular that's taking an innovative approach to this very promising technology. The average battery is fully enclosed, but what if we took all the chemicals out and stored it in a tank and pumped them through the actual cell? What sort of pros and cons would we be looking at? I had the opportunity to meet with ESS, the Iron Flow Battery Company, and we'll talk about why I'm so bullish on their technology and approach on this deep dive here on Two Bit da Vinci. Special thanks to Roborock for sponsoring this video. Check out my absolute favorite robot vacuum cleaner, the S7 Plus, link in the video description. Like we said up top, we've covered lots of different battery technology. Flow batteries share many similarities with other battery tech out there, but also have some key differences. So in, let's say, a lithium-ion battery, you have your anode, your cathode, a separator, and an electrolyte, which carries positive charge ions from anode to the cathode or vice versa. To discharge, the anode releases lithium ions, hence the name, to the cathode, generating the movement of electrons to the other side. During charging, the process is reversed. With flow batteries, the energy is actually stored in the electrolyte itself. So instead of a cathode and an anode, you'd have a catholyte and an analyte, stored in liquid form in two separate containers. There are a few different types of flow batteries, but the most common one is called a redox flow battery. Here's how they work. An energy source, let's say a wind turbine, charges the battery by pumping electrons from the catholyte, the positive solution, past a membrane where they exchange ions inducing an electric current, with charge added or removed through two electrodes, a process called oxidation, while it also pushes those electrons into the analyte or negative solution, a process called reduction. So oxidation plus reduction, redox. Energy gets stored by increasing the potential difference between the two solutions. In other words, oxidizing one and reducing the other. Energy capacity is purely a function of tank size. The power is a function of the anode surface area. Unlike a typical battery, expanding on a flow battery could be as simple as adding more analyte or catholyte into the tanks. To produce energy, the process is reversed. One of the most common materials used for the electrolyte solution is vanadium, the 20th most abundant element in the Earth's crust, at a rate of 120 parts per million. It's more abundant than nickel at around 84, or lithium at 20. But compared to really common elements like aluminum at 82,000 ppm and iron at 56,000 ppm, vanadium is still not exactly easy to come by. Prices and supplies of vanadium have stayed pretty stable, but when we think about the scale of production we'll need to truly add energy storage to our energy grid, you have to start thinking about the resulting strain on raw material supply chains. Lithium and lithium-ion batteries are incredible. They power everything from our phones and computers to our cars, and even we're starting to see them scaled up for grid storage. They're relatively cheap and very energy dense. But when it comes to grid storage, there are some excellent reasons to look for other materials besides lithium. First and foremost, we're going to need a lot of lithium to power things like electric vehicles, for example. In fact, while lithium certainly can and does work for grid storage, it really shines when energy density is crucial, places like in cars and maybe one day in airplanes. There's also an issue of safety. Now, we know the risk of lithium-ion batteries is really minimal, and it tends to get blown way out of proportion by the media, especially compared to combustion engines, which, you know, have a synonym for explosion right there in the name. But lithium-ion batteries do have some inherent dangers that need to be designed for. Well, if the goal is safety, if energy density isn't that important, as we can have these grid batteries be built outside of town where there's plenty of space and land, and material choice is of the paramount importance, then very few battery choices make as much sense as the iron flow battery. Let me explain why. If we're going to seriously scale up grid storage to allow sunshine to be stored for the evening and to provide stability for the unpredictable nature of renewable energy sources, then we need to be thinking about huge battery installations. Iron is one of the most important elements in our civilization, and it is a very good thing that it is so abundant. Luckily for me, our sponsor this week is Roborock, and this, the Roborock S7 Plus smart vacuum and mopping robot with auto emptying dock. The S7 Plus is ridiculously smart. With LiDAR to scan your house and create maps of every room and hallway. Then, if there are areas you want to avoid, like this area under my bed, just open the app and draw a no-go zone. With the auto-empty dock, you don't even have to remember to clean the bin, as it cleans itself for up to 8 weeks when it returns to the dock to charge. The 2500 Pascal suction power makes quick work of everything it encounters, big and small, on hard floors or carpet. Its 5200 amp battery is good for up to 3 hours of cleaning and over 2,000 square feet. The S7 Plus can even mop your hard floors. It's smart enough to raise the mopping pad over carpet, and with its sonic vibration technology, it scrubs your floors up to 3,000 times per minute. With my kids and dogs, I schedule my S7 Plus to vacuum daily, and even do a mopping session in the common areas when everyone's asleep each night. So save time cleaning and support the show by getting a Roborock S7 Plus, link in the video description. ESS was kind enough to give me a tour of their headquarters in Oregon, where they are working on an iron flow battery. While most flow batteries have two separate tanks, one for the cathode and one for the analyte, ESS's design only has one tank. So what makes the ESS iron flow battery special? Well, the ingredients involved are simply water, salt, and iron. That's it. There's no lithium, there's no nickel, no cobalt. Here's how the charge and discharge cycle works. In the discharge state, the electrolyte is made up of iron ions, Fe2+, and supporting salts dissolved in water. This mixture is the same for both the positive and negative electrolytes. During charge, the Fe2+ ions in the negative electrolyte combine with the electrons and plate onto the negative electrode as elemental iron. When fully charged, the negative electrolyte has very little iron remaining in solution, and the positive electrolyte is mostly Fe3+ ions. During discharge, the reverse reaction occurs. So what's happening is actually a plating reaction, where elemental iron is being plated to the negative electrode, which represents the charge state.
All right, so this is one of our 50-cell stacks. Each cell runs an open circuit voltage around 1.1 volts. Because it's a flow battery, we don't connect them in series to get to the high voltage levels. We actually pass that through a DC-DC converter to boost the voltage from the stack voltage up to the DC voltage that we want to connect into the systems at. So that brings it from the stack voltage up to 850 volts. So the lithium system, if they have a half a volt lithium cell, they just stack them up in series to get up to 1,000 or 1,200 volts. And that means that when the voltage sags, you have that whole range drops down. So it's operating over a huge DC voltage range. Because we're not stacking them in series, there is no sag at the high voltage level. Right, that stays very stable. So this is all of the mechanical equipment that's in the energy warehouse. What you're seeing down below is the main pumps to run the equipment. And then above that is the electrolyte health system. So all of that equipment is really for cycling our electrolyte to maintain it and balance its chemistry. And so that's something that's unique to flow batteries, that we can run that continuously, even while we're operating the battery, and keep the electrolyte in balance and clean.
Every battery off gases or has some type of side reaction during every charge cycle, same as ours. In our case, those side reactions, ions are produced, and in our closed loop system, we created technology, which is a big reservoir of our IP. So it is how we can process that continuously in a closed loop system so that the electrolyte is continuously refreshed. So at the beginning of every cycle, the battery is essentially a brand new battery. You see the two, looks like mini stacks up at the top?
Yeah.
Those are the kidneys. That does that processing.
What's equally exciting about this approach is how easily an iron flow battery can be scaled up. First, you can increase the volume of the liquid tank, or add more tanks and the salt and the iron solution. Then you just need to add more cells, increasing the capacity for iron plating to occur. So an ESS flow battery could be started small and be added onto later, much like a Tesla Powerwall or Megapack. But unlike a lithium ion battery that has a life cycle of around 1,000 cycles, or lithium iron phosphate chemistries that are closer to 3,000 to 4,000 cycles before losing about 20% of their capacity, ESS claims that their iron flow batteries can easily last 20,000 cycles with minimal degradation and minimal cost. Plus, in regards to safety, the iron salt solution is so safe, if poured on top of a fire, it would actually put the fire out.
It's water-based battery, so it's not gonna blow up in a fire, not going to start a fire. It's a fire stopper, not a fire starter, in other words.
Plus, if any of the liquid ever leaked, it's not even hazardous to the environment.
We had one experience in the field where we had damage to a system. A system that we're deploying as a pilot back in 2017, and a couple of cups, maybe a quarter or two of electrolyte spilled. There was some cracks in the plumbing that happened during transport. You don't discover that until after you're putting fluid in and it's kind of leaking out. The actual remediation was dry it out, power wash it. That was the literal remediation for that spill.
Now that is truly a safe battery. What about environmental friendliness and recyclability?
The electrolyte itself is fully recyclable. We could use it in another battery. Remember, it's just iron saturated in salt water. Nothing's evaporating out, nothing's leaving it. You could dry it out and take all the salts. Those salts are the same salts used in winter de-icing operations. They're the same salts used in wastewater treatment. You could take the dried salts, you could landfill them, and dispose it. It's the same kind of materials you find in fertilizer. The electrolyte at this facility, if we wanted, we could literally put it down the drain. We have to do two things before we would do that. One is we'd have to neutralize the pH. You know, the operating pH of this is about the same pH as a glass of wine, but we do have to neutralize it. So neutralize it. Second is just filter it for solids so we're not throwing chunks down the drain or putting solids that would clog a drain.
So if all this is sounding pretty good and you've seen our videos before, you're probably asking, okay, so what are the engineering trade-offs one has to make when going with an iron flow battery? Well, first of all, the battery is far less energy and power dense than lithium ion batteries. So you'll never see iron flow batteries powering the EVs of the future. But how important is energy and power density for stationary storage? So if you need to charge or discharge really quickly, it's still quite hard to beat the lithium ion battery. The iron flow battery is far less energy and power dense than the lithium ion battery. But the more interesting question is, does it matter? Unlike in a plane or a car, the added need for weight or space isn't really a deal breaker. The stationary weight clearly isn't as much of a concern, even for the larger footprint required, could be offset by placing these energy warehouses under massive solar arrays. In my opinion, using very cheap and abundant elements for our future energy storage is by far the biggest key point. For instance, consider the Tesla Hornsdale plant in South Australia, which is a 193 megawatt hour battery plant. If we used iron flow batteries for the plant instead, sure, it would take up more land, but it would save enough lithium ion batteries to build over 2,400 80 kilowatt hour battery pack EVs. It's hard to think about scarcity, especially since the world has always seemed so vast and endless. But as we transition to building millions of electric vehicles, everything we can do to alleviate supply chain strains will be crucial. So incredibly safe, uses some of the most abundant materials on Earth, very affordable and has long cycle lifetimes. But it takes so much more space and weight. But that can't be it, right? I mean, if the iron flow battery really was such a slam dunk, why hasn't anybody else sorted it out yet? Well, it turns out there are a few key challenges that have until now not been solved.
So the two main challenges with the iron-based chemistry, one is going to be around side reactions, and the second one is going to be around the proton imbalance. And so as the battery is operating, say the battery is charging, there's basically a perfect reaction on the positive side. Every amp that goes in goes to useful work. On the negative side of the battery, however, every amp that goes in, around 1% of that is converted to hydrogen. It's not useful. Just because of the potential for operating, and you'll evolve hydrogen. And so what happens is over time, the positive state of charge of the battery will get higher state of charge than the negative side. And because you're also evolving hydrogen, you're also losing protons in the system, which means the pH is gonna rise. And during charge, the protons are gonna stream from the positive side to the negative side, and then they're going to evolve into hydrogen. And over time, the pH is going to rise, and you could form those hydroxides on the positive side. What the proton pump does is it essentially takes that hydrogen that was evolved and converts it back into a proton on the positive side. And when it does that, it also brings the state of charge in balance as well. So the proton pump really keeps the battery in state of charge balance and also in pH balance.
My name is Julia San. I'm the co-founder and chief technology officer of ESS. You know, in terms of a flow battery, so iron flow battery particularly, I think one of the things I like to highlight is that, you know, people are familiar with batteries. You go to the store, you buy these batteries that are coming as this battery packs, right? So essentially, what's inside the packs are chemicals. and these chemicals are used to store energy. Now, the difference between a traditional battery that you can go to the store and buy and versus a flow battery technology is that we take all the chemicals that are inside a battery essentially out, and they are stored in an external tank. Now, what difference does that make? Well, you know, I can tell you right now, as an electrochemist, there is no battery system that can ever achieve 100% efficiency, which means that every time you charge and discharge your batteries, the chemicals inside the packed cell are going to become a little bit imbalanced, which means that over cycle to cycle to cycle, that chemical imbalance gets bigger and bigger and bigger, to the point that, you know, you notice your phone is not lasting as long as it used to be at the beginning of the time. Now, that gives us the advantage, however, by storing that chemicals outside in the tank. When we can do that, that means that we can actually manage the chemical state of charge externally. And that's essentially what the proton pump does, is that we have all these chemicals outside in the electrolyte tank. We have a proton pump that's there constantly working to keep the electrolyte always in balance. And that really is a big difference between flow batteries and iron flow batteries versus a traditional lithium ion or lead acid batteries. Then that's how we can achieve cycle to cycle capacity does not fade and performance does not degrade.
We actually started in the garage at our condo back in 2011 until we had FDA stuff came to ask us why we were getting chemicals delivered to our house. And so that eventually had to stop. We actually had to get a real place. And so we moved to the Portland State Business Accelerator. I think we have like a 200 square foot facility, or basically small labs.
Yep.
That's where we did most of our work at that point.
And you guys are now, I heard, about 140 employees?
Close to about 140 employees, and instead of having 200 square feet, we now have close to 200,000 square feet. So
yeah.
Much bigger facility, much bigger labs. We have manufacturing with robots now, so it's a big change.
ESS believes they are currently at cost parity with something like a Tesla Megapack, but they believe their long-term costs might be even more favorable because of their 20,000 cycle lifetimes. Grid batteries might charge and discharge more than once in a day, given especially challenging circumstances. And these are the sorts of advantages that will loom even larger for the iron flow battery. One important thing to note is that this battery has moving parts. It has water pumps and other hardware to facilitate the charging and discharging process. This, I believe, is why we will never see residential-sized iron flow batteries. A lithium-ion battery, like a Tesla Powerwall, has zero maintenance to perform, no moving parts, and nothing to replace for the life of the battery. With the iron flow battery, there will be some sort of a maintenance interval to make sure that there are no leaks, make sure the electrolyte is in balance, and make sure that all the pumps are working properly. These sorts of maintenance processes are easy to handle on a grid-scale project, but could pose some serious problems for the average consumer. So these iron flow batteries from ESS are not for cars or planes, not for residential homes. What they are is a perfectly thought out, highly scalable, and environmentally friendly solution to one of the decade's greatest challenges. Sure, we need electric vehicles, but where does the electricity come from? For anyone who's ever said EVs are just coal-powered cars, grid-level storage is the counterpoint. We have more than enough sunshine and wind for all of our energy needs. The problem has always been storing it for a cloudy day. I cover a lot of batteries in this channel, and I have to tell you, I think the ESS Iron Flow battery might be the most promising battery I've investigated all year. The company will be merging to go public, and they're quickly reaching production and shipping to customers. Huge vats filled with iron salts might not seem glamorous, but this thing just might be one of the most necessary innovations in decades. Okay, so this is a look at the Iron Flow battery. What do you guys think? Am I missing something? Do I have a good reason to be as excited about the company and its technology as I am? Sound off in the comments below. That is a look at the Iron Flow battery. This is one of those technologies that I'm super excited about. I think the fact that it uses really abundant materials is the key, because I want to see terawatt hours of energy storage around the globe. And when we start to think about it in those scale and in those terms, every little bit really counts. So that does it for us. Huge shout out to all of you guys for watching, and thank you for supporting the show. If you want to be a rock star supporter of the show, consider becoming a patron on Patreon or a YouTube channel member. We call you guys a tribe. We'd love to have you on our Discord so we can chat and meet up sometimes, and you can help with our scripts and plan videos. And generally, just take a look around. There's some other videos that we think you're probably going to like. I'm Rick with Two Bit da Vinci, and just remember, the future is going to be awesome.